Hello and greetings from Iceland. This is one of those big days when all the warning systems wake up and the Mother Earth gets all the headlines. And in this case, it was the ice-capped central volcano Bárðarbunga that looked as it was getting ready to erupt. And what we got was the largest seismic swarm since before the 2014 Bárðarbunga eruption. And although things seem to be cooling down now, the scenario might not be over. It might just as well be just starting. So let's look at what scientists are saying about this huge volcano, or what to expect. And the most likely scenario is something like 2014, when the seismic swarm under the caldera migrated as it was forming a magma dike that crawled from under the caldera to an old lava field 45 kilometers away and erupted there. And this is how it looked on the seismometers back then, or a process that took less than 2 weeks. This might be the most likely scenario now. It might be a harmless eruption, but it all depends on where it comes up, of course, and how large. Like the 2014 eruption, it turned out to be the largest effusive eruption in Iceland since the 1783 Laki eruption. But lava has also migrated to the southwest end of the fissure swarm, where we have landscape like this. That should give you an idea about the forces that we are dealing with this time. Or to make this clear, Bárðarbunga is one of the big players. We are told that it sits above the mantle plume, and the fissure swarm is 200 kilometers long. And we could also be faced with a subglacial eruption under this huge caldera. But the outcome will depend on the exact location of where the fires come up. That location determines whether the flood flows north, south, or even both ways. And let's start in the north, where the flood will likely follow the path of this river, Jökulsá. And we can see the history of major floods there, wherever we look around here. And this waterfall, Dettifoss, has an average water flow of 200 cubic meters per second, and the largest known flood around here was estimated to be 900,000 cubic meters. And the waterfall does actually look quite small when we look at the surroundings and what happened here in the past. And if we go a bit further down, closer to the sea, we find the Ásbyrgi Canyon, and legend has it that a flood due to eruption in Bárðarbunga carved this out, and there is not one single boulder to be found around there. All of this material was just washed away out to the sea. So this has been a place of interest for me, for the channel, for a long time, and this should give you an idea about the glacial floods of the past. And there was a discussion about flood risk after the 2014 Bárðarbunga eruption, but like the eruption, the discussion faded out. But this location, the canyon and the river, all the way up to the glacier, is one of the reasons for my camera upgrade last year, because some of the footage that I need for a future project will have to be shot from a plane. But I have already been filming a lot around here with a drone, so I have more to show you soon. And it is widely believed that Bárðarbunga is responsible for many of the landscape features around here, around the river. But how bad things could get after an eruption in Bárðarbunga is unknown. And let's say that the caldera will erupt and we get a flood, and the flood goes to the south, things will get even more complicated there. And I've mentioned this before in regards to Bárðarbunga, that we have many eggs in one basket there, as for electricity production in the river Þjórsá. And that river could be affected with floods. It could even wipe out dams and power plants. So when I'm done with this video, I'm going to look for the risk assessment report I know I have somewhere, because I had a feeling that I might need it soon. So although we are faced with two basic scenarios, subglacial eruption or a magma dike, there are still many variations to think of, especially when it comes to a subglacial eruption. That would very likely be the worst case scenario. And then we have another factor, and that is the air pollution that could reach extreme levels near the volcano And Bárðarbunga is a kind of volcano that can have a global impact. But let's not panic though. The magma chamber of Bárðarbunga isn't full according to scientists, who are saying that this scenario now is a surprise. But as for the Civil Protection Agency and Aviation Authorities, Bárðarbunga is already on code yellow and all our systems on full alert. But things have, however, been cooling down since this morning. But seismic activity could, of course, start again. And I am somehow not expecting that Bárðarbunga will erupt this time. But there is another scenario that could arise, just like I mentioned in a recent video, where I made my prediction for 2025, or that this could end up with a traditional Grímsvötn eruption. And those two systems, Grímsvötn and Bárðarbunga, they are closely related, and many remember the 1996 event, when the subglacial eruption took place midst between those two giant systems. So it would not surprise me if this would lead to a, what we can call a moderate subglacial eruption, that could go on for a few days or a couple of weeks, and things will cool down after that. And the reason why I placed Bárðarbunga in the third place as one of the most likely volcanoes to erupt in 2025 has to do with the fact that the caldera drop after the 2014 eruption was a whopping 65 meters, but the uplift since then is little over 20 meters. So experts are saying that Bárðarbunga is simply not due, but Grímsvötn volcano is due, for sure. And moreover, a flood started there yesterday, and my plan was to make a video about that flood today, because that ice-covered caldera fills with meltwater every now and then from geothermal activity, and when the lake above the caldera fills up, it lifts the ice above, the water takes off, and it comes from under this glacier that we call Skeiðarárjökull, down to those sands. But I'm going to do a separate story about that soon, because I have new footage from here that I haven't published before. And the last runoff from Grímsvötn was just a year ago, which indicates increased geothermal activity there. But I want to make it clear that scientists have been saying today that the floods are not related to the Bárðarbunga unrest, although it is a known fact that the risk of a volcanic eruption increases after floods. And the last such scenario was in 2004, when a flood triggered a subglacial eruption. And earthquakes in Bárðarbunga are known to trigger eruptions in Grímsvötn. So what we have seen are two events within 2 days, and both of them are known triggers that can trigger eruptions in Grímsvötn. So the next days, they will for sure be quite exciting, not just around Bárðarbunga. We should also look at Grímsvötn. And since we are here, I need to talk a little about tourism. But to make this simple, if I had a friend coming to Iceland soon, I would say no worries. It requires a special effort to get into problems even during a subglacial eruptions somewhere in the wilderness. And volcano warnings from Vatnajökull glacier have been quite frequent. But as for volcano watchers, that's not an easy location to work with, which is bad news for types like me. But I've been preparing for a long time for a subglacial eruption that has rarely been captured with the modern day camera equipment here in Iceland. And that's one of the reasons why I'm so eager to get such footage. So my camera is ready, and my lenses, and I know about all the airports from where I can get sightseeing tours. I even have my super zoom camera ready, and when I woke up this morning and looked at the earthquake plot, I thought, I hope my car will be ready today. And lucky me, I got an SMS shortly thereafter, telling me to pick it up from a big repair. And it didn't take me long to pick it up, but I was late for the annual inspection, stopped by there and came back with another list of things to fix, but not enough to stop me from moving on the road soon, if needed. But as the day has developed, I had the feeling that this was just an exercise, and for those of us who want to see or capture volcano footage from a subglacial eruption, this is terrible timing. First of all, the days are still very short, and the visibility of the glacier will be awful the next days. So as it looks now, this might have just been an exercise to tell us to prepare well. And as I mentioned in my prediction video for 2025, what we want are those short-lived and harmless eruptions under the glacier. So a small or a moderate subglacial eruption might just as well be the best outcome now. And I hope this explains the basics, but I will of course do another update soon if needed. And with that, I'm sending you best regards from the volcano island, Iceland.